Hello, my name is Carlo Generelli. I'm the producer and director of the series called The Temples of Rock. And we've traveled around the world, from Los Angeles to San Francisco to New York, London, and finally here, Liverpool, where I'm standing actually by the actual Mersey River. But I'd like to say this, we came here to do a rockumentary, if you will, but we got much more. And I'd like to show you at this time the making of The Temples of Rock.
Okay, are we ready? Hey, isn't that fucking Picasso, man? Let's rock. This is just Rock Palace or something.
Fuck you.
Fuck you.
This is some kind of cosmic joke.
The Apollo Theater is...
When did you play first time?
I'm going to tell you.
I'm sorry.
Adam, I'm telling you, I don't want you to do a thing. Everything you're doing, we're getting.
This drinking is not for publication.
Fuck, never mind. I just completely went blank. I can't go this long without a cig.
Stop a second. Let me just call Jerry and ask him the name of the club.
I thought I was going to have to kick Mick Jagger's ass.
By the way, you're going to edit all this so I don't sound like a complete idiot, right?
Don't ever look at this camera.
Oh, don't look at the camera. Okay.
Somebody's snoring. I just want you to know.
God, I thought this was about travel.
We'll be right back with more of whatever the fuck this show is called.
Our first big road trip took us to Orlando, Florida, where the Hard Rock chain generously offered the use of their newly opened attraction, the Hard Rock Vault, as the setting for our on-camera stand-ups.
Hey, Bob, are you in the gym for this?
Yes.
So late on a Sunday night, we began our taping of the Temples of Rock with host Ray Manzarek of The Doors. He was a professional, and we quickly ran through all the takes.
Hi, I'm Ray Manzarek of The Doors. Welcome back to the Temples of Rock. Come on along to the places where rock and roll history was made. The Temples of Rock and Roll. Come on along. Come on along. Let me take you by the hand. Get out of there.
Mark, what you want?
Welcome back to the Temples of Rock.
The trip to the West Coast started with a stopover in Las Vegas to interview two of the founders of Chicago. They were playing a gig at the Stardust Hotel's Wayne Newton Theater, and the interview took place in the busy backstage area about an hour before the show.
And I'm going, Walt, what did he say? What did he say, Walt? Walt goes, I think we're fired. And so...
Excuse me, Donnie, could you have him cut the organ?
Yeah, cut everything.
Down the middle aisle, here comes a guy with long hair. All of a sudden,
whoa, hey, what do you say?
Anyhow, you know, when Frank said when this orange landed, he stopped the band, and he says, whoever did that, come down here right now, pick it up.
He just came down and got on him and told him right now, sorry.
Okay. Frank looks at the orange, goes, okay, stops the band. Whoever did that?
Wait. You guys keep walking behind you.
I mean, hippie, you know, or late 60s, shuffles down to the front, picks up the orange, and goes, no, that's okay. We're not shooting anything here.
We're doing TV
here,
man. Quit walking by, okay, please? Jesus Christ. Okay, guys, we're done. Bang away.
I took the red eye to Los Angeles, and the next morning I met up with my friend and cameraman, Bill Day. We headed to Graham Nash's house for an interview.
I have been present at some really great moments in rock and roll history, and I just feel so fortunate that I was conscious enough to actually go down that path.
Nash was a legend in his own mind, but it made for a great interview.
Well, you're all talented, obviously. You can't just do it because you were there.
No, the best, the cream rose to the top, you know.
The next day, we headed to the Whiskey A Go Go to meet up with Ray Manzarek, a place where Ray had played many times with The Doors.
This is the world famous, what is this place?
Ray showed up in a foul mood, but once I paid him the $5,000 we owed him, he perked up.
They had go-go girls here. You should have seen them in their booths, man, in the little cages that they would dance in with the shimmy, frilly outfits, little white go-go boots. They were cute as can be. Jim probably poked quite a few in his time. The Sunset Strip was a great place.
We rushed to Beverly Hills to interview Johnny Ramone at his talent agent's office. It was another audio nightmare.
It's obviously...
Can we stop for a second?
Yeah.
These women are talking just a little bit too loud.
Can you just tell them?
I think she just left. I think it's going
to be a boisterous woman.
A boisterous woman, yeah.
They always cut through everything else, their voices, yeah.
Right.
They should be seen and not heard.
If they would just take it down just a little bit, we'd be fine.
I have to close it. Here we go.
Yeah, tell them to take it down 20 decibels.
The whole scene, give me a favor.
Same one.
Just tell the world out there.
Yeah, shut that dame up.
The next morning, we were scheduled to interview Sunset Strip legend Johnny Rivers in my hotel room. Unfortunately, it rained that day, and Rivers called up saying he couldn't do the interview because he didn't want to get his boots muddy.
And look at this. Look what Carlo got you. He said he was going to get you Johnny Rivers, and he got him for you.
On the Sunset Strip.
Right there.
So, Johnny, what was it like being a rock and roll icon in Los Angeles in 1964?
Can you speak up a little bit louder? We're not getting enough volume on our sound here. Johnny, we can't hear you. You got to speak up.
Silence.
Was on to San Francisco in the Fillmore Auditorium, where I was scheduled to interview the Grateful Dead's Phil Lesh and Mickey Hart. But Mickey Hart showed up about 3 hours early like a bat out of hell, his hair blown out by the wild ride he took there. I suspected he was fueled by Bolivian marching powder. It was one of the weirdest and quickest interviews I did.
You ready? Are we finally ready? Are we rolling? No. Okay, all right, go ahead. Go ahead. And nothing is wrong with me either. I mean, I've been able to make it all these years. You look like Francis Coppola. I know Francis.
Fortunately, Phil Lesh was kind enough to wait around for his turn. He turned out to be significantly more mellow. But in the middle of his interview, camera assist Terry Schwartz almost choked to death on some ancient Fillmore dust.
Bless you. Okay, so are we?
I think it's a little dusty or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Have some water.
The highlight of the San Francisco trip was uncovering light show inventor Bill Ham. He was an 80-year-old psychedelic relic, still doing what he was doing in 1967, in his basement, playing with lights and liquids and smoking dope.
Good. Looking good.
All right.
He supports himself by videotaping light shows and selling them on the internet.
I'll just do selling any of the videos. I want to buy one.
Yeah, $20.
$20. Okay.
Yeah. All right.
Travel Channel exec Mark Finkelpearl came to the San Francisco shoot. He was very supportive of the project.
Temples of
One of the most memorable New York interviews was a very nervous Billy J. Kramer. He drank about 20 cups of coffee before he sat down in front of the camera.
For goodness sake, I got the hippie shade.
And, where are we going from here now with this?
Well, you know,
I don't know. I'm just saying.
No, I'm just curious.
Am I going to contradict myself here? I hope not. You know, you're asking me such a hard question.
You have to understand that you have an insight that not many people have.
Right.
You really do. I mean, I don't know who's there. He doesn't know who is there. You know?
Is this going to get cut over or what?
Is there anything else you want to cover that we haven't covered?
No, I can't really think.
I think we covered quite a bit.
You think so? Yeah. But I mean, did it look relaxed enough?
Yeah, I think we're fine.
Oh,
yeah.
Very well.
Yeah.
Very well.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, back in L.A., Bill Day had caught up with the owner of the Whiskey A Go-Go, Mario Malieri.
And the phone rang right in the middle of that story.
Unfortunately, the interview took place in his noisy office with many expletives to be deleted.
So, see when the phone stops ringing. I don't suppose you're going to shut that off.
That ain't going to stop ringing.
Yeah,
I don't want that fucking drink. I want the whole fucking bottle. And she got the whole bottle. And she drank that shit like crazy.
So the phone rang right in the middle of it. So tell me that story about Janice. What kind of girl was Janice?
Janice was she was a nice girl. She liked her booze. She was Southern Comfort all she drank. She was a nice lady, great entertainer, which I love very much, not just for her music, just as a person, she's just a great lady. Fucking phone.
Bill finally got Mario to leave the noisy office and went for a ride with him to his other club, the Rainbow.
Says there's a sign we're open. Don't nobody know we're open? Guy with his motorcycle. Probably Lemmy. You know Lemmy from Motorhead?
No.
He's here. You don't know Motorhead? The group?
No.
You're kidding me.
No, I don't.
What the hell are you doing? You don't know nothing about...
I'm a travel guy, not a rock guy.
You never heard of Motorhead? Lemmy? Yeah, God, they know this guy all over the world. He got stuck in England and wouldn't give him a visa back, so he finally got back about a week ago. They finally let him through.
Oh, okay. So is he a musician?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So maybe he's here.
I might be.
We'll find out.
Check it out. Come on, boy. That's your bike or what? You always eat, but you don't get fatter. This is my son, Mike.
Hey, Mike, how are you?
Just gave me a check for $25,000 for appearing on Travel Channel.
1, 2, 3, 4. The trip to England found me and Bill Day together on the road again. We started our journey in London, where we had hoped to shoot at Abbey Road Studios. But once we got there, they denied us access. Eventually, I had to drop the segment from the show. So we took some tourist pics, and then we moved on. We traveled 2 hours out of London into the English countryside to the home of Cream bassist Jack Bruce.
Hi.
He was the only rock star I interviewed who insisted on being paid. Shortly before we got there, we settled on the sum of $250 in small, unmarked bills.
I could have been a pimp, you know, that's another story. That costs more, that one is more expensive.
Great. Let's. How about the Marvin Gaye connection?
Marvin Gaye, but that's got nothing to do with this. I think I'll hold back on that one. This has got nothing to do with.
I'm doing a session on Motown too, you know.
Motown is not a venue.
It's also about.
It costs more, honestly.
Jack Bruce was willing to tell me, however, about his great Scottish granddad, who actually developed the system of signals and hand signs now used in American baseball games. He was good enough to demonstrate them for me. Bill Day had arranged for a British friend of his, Richard Goodwin, to be our driver and camera assist. He had once worked with David Lean on Lawrence of Arabia, but now he was schlepping for the Temples of Rock.
We're on our way to see the singing Blue Jeans.
Swinging Blue Jeans.
Swinging Blue Jeans. And the Mersey Beat Boys.
On the way, Richard.
And Swansea in Wales.
We went to Wales to catch an oldies tour of bands that had played the Cavern Club. After the sit-down interviews, they invited us to see the show. But if you live in the USA, man, it must be cool. I never lived in the USA. I'm just a farmer from Liverpool. Just a farmer from Liverpool. Just a farmer from Liverpool. Just a farmer from Liverpool.
Let's go, lads.
There's all the reprobates.
Don't bring those bleeding American bastards around here.
There's all the reprobates in
there. This is the amateur's dressing room.
Excuse me, you can tell, just look at him.
No, look at him.
Look at the way he's holding the guitar.
But I'll tell you who's on stage.
Go on.
Pete Best. That's why he's not there.
That's right.
Also on the tour was the ultimate rock loser, Pete Best. He declined to be interviewed or even speak to me.
And we also have a drink as well.
Ooh.
We drink the old white grain. Now this is Imperial. It's from a local off license called Threshers. It's good stuff. Because if you go like that, you drop the top, but then you could actually make the oh in the hippie hippie shake. Oh,
at the end of the show, all the bands came on stage for a rousing sing-along finish. They asked me to join them on stage as well. However, I thought it was best to decline. But when they invited me back to the hotel for the Liverpool-style rap party, I decided to go along.
Here we are in Swansea, bidding it farewell. After a quite eventful evening. With the lads from Mersey.
With the lads. The Mersey beat.
The Mersey beat.
Rock and roll.
Rock, and where are we going today?
Liverpool, the cradle of rock and roll in Britain.
We arrived in Liverpool on a beautiful sunny day and were surprised to find Liverpool had one of the biggest Chinatowns in the world.
So, Carlo, what makes a temple of rock a temple of rock?
Well, you see, back then, when Jerry Molson was around, and the Beats, there were no temples. There were just little shacks. Little shacks of rock. Sometimes a small lean-to of rock. But there were no temples. Not as you know them today.
That's a story about a sailor in Liverpool.
Oh, that's what we're very apropos.
With a Liverpool prostitute.
Well, I think it's apropos.
And he's very, very drunk. And after he's been on the job for a little while, he said, how am I doing here? You're doing about 3 knots. You're not in, you're not hard, and you're not getting your money back.
This is what I paid for. See? This is my crew.
In addition to our shoot at the Cavern Club in Liverpool, we were set to interview British invasion legend Jerry Marsden of Jerry and the Pacemakers. At one point, I thought he was getting set to Shake Me Down, Jack Bruce style.
I just need you the appearance release when we're done. So that's what I'm going to have. It says I can use you in the shop.
Does this mean you're paying me as well?
No, it says you'll never get paid.
Fuck me, the usual crap.
Put the lights on.
Found an artifact that I think really ties up the connection between all the fabulous places we've done, from San Francisco to Los Angeles, New York, here in Liverpool, London. Buried deep inside these bricks, we found an original Bill Ham video cassette. Must have been produced sometime early in the 60s. And it kind of throws a kink into everything because it just ties it all together and shows what a small world it is.
Bill and I headed down south to cover the story of Sun Studio. Once we hit Nashville, we heard a song about redneck girls. It became our mantra for the next 5 days. Redneck girl likes to cruise and daddy's pickup. Our driver on this trip was a local boy named Opie.
So what do you think of our local driver so far?
He's great, except that he put the car on the curb.
No, that song goes straight out.
What was that?
That song goes straight out.
Oh, I see, so a quick getaway.
It is.
So we have
you
a quick
never
getaway.
Know.
No, there you
you see,
go.
That's advanced driving. You don't even know about New York.
Where's the best place to look for some redneck girls? So you can
the
see.
The best place is Legends. It's actually at the corner of Broadway and 4th.
Oh, okay.
No, that's the best place.
That's it, huh?
The bartenders will get you just hammered. They're girl bartenders.
Oh, really? We might have to take Carlo to one of those places.
What'd they do to us?
I don't know. You can't read it.
This is the parking ticket that Bill Day will have to take care of.
Oh, yeah, right.
I can't, do you know, can you run that?
No, give it to him. Who cares, he's paying it, yeah.
Tire on curb violation.
Is that what it says?
$85.
A redneck girl likes to stay out all night long. She makes sweet.
We heard a song last night. We're country music efficient. But we heard a song last night. Some guys were playing something about finding a redneck girl or. I want a redneck girl.
Give me a redneck girl.
Yes, that was it.
Bellamy Brothers.
Bellamy Brothers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Give me a redneck girl.
It's not called Redneck Girl, so.
Yeah, that's it. I think they just put it on this one.
Right.
All the redneck girls forever.
Oh, this is great, though. That's terrific.
What's a redneck girl to you?
We are on the hunt for the proverbial redneck girl.
Now, what, in your mind, what do you think a redneck woman should look like?
Well, I think she should have a redneck, whether it be painted or sunburned or maybe even a scarf. But the neck actually should be red.
Give me a redneck girl.
When you hear those guys saying, I want a redneck woman, I mean, what defines her? The way she walks, the way she talks?
A lot of the way she talks, very country. Priorities probably more on beer and cigarettes than maybe a little heavy on the makeup, but they're overcompensating.
What kind of cigarettes would you smoke?
Oh, shit.
Well, you know, it's a guess. Chesterfield?
Probably Marlboro Red.
Marlboro Red and beer? Beer of choice?
Definitely a Busch or a Pabst Blue Ribbon.
Pabst Blue Ribbon. I haven't drank Pabst Blue Ribbon in 20 years. And tonight, I'm going to have a Pabst Blue Ribbon, if I can find it.
Can I ask you a quick question? What kind of cigarettes do you smoke?
Marlboro 100s.
In the red box?
Yes.
Are there real redneck girls around here that look like this?
I know a few.
But how do we know when we found them? That's if no one can tell us.
Do they look like that?
Yeah, they look like that. No, I don't know. Go up and ask them. Have this in your hand. Just like, excuse me, you're a redneck girl?
Okay, all right. Good answer.
How do you tell?
Like your redneck girl will say, yeah,
say, yeah,
sure.
Golly.
You betcha.
Like her down there, she won?
No, she's more of a hillbilly than a redneck.
Oh, Lordy.
Headed to Memphis.
Tonight she's gonna know she got a boogie woogie, man. I heard it, you. We're gonna boogie woogie tonight. Yeah.
First night in Memphis, we went to see a band called the Dempseys. They had more energy than they knew what to do with. So we asked them the $64,000 question. What is a redneck girl?
What is a redneck? You know, man, you want to go to West Memphis, Arkansas, man. You don't want
to. All right, we got a lead last night. Redneck girls are over here. West Memphis.
Arkansas.
That's where we're going.
We looked high and we looked low. But still no redneck girls in sight. What we did find was a place to park and eat.
So what do you feel like for lunch today?
I think I'll have some turnip greens, potatoes and gravy, some white beans, and some sweetened tea.
I heard this song last night called
I'd Rather Have a Redneck Girl, but I've never seen one. What does a redneck girl look like?
Don't know.
You never seen a redneck girl?
Nope.
What kind of girls do you look at?
I look at them cute little sexy little blondes, man.
Give me a redneck girl.
So we left Arkansas without a redneck girl, but with a determination to return to the land of Elvis, back to Memphis, and to Sun Studio, where we knew we could find the definitive answer. What is a redneck girl?
A redneck woman is raised on a farm, and she sees animals. And animals, they're not very shy. They just kind of reproduce wherever. And let's just say that redneck girls like to roll in the hay. Redneck girls aren't afraid to take a little nip. Redneck girls don't mind if you pick them up with muddy boots on in a pickup truck. Redneck girls are low maintenance, high loving. My wife was born in Tupelo, Mississippi. She was raised on a farm in Walls. She was from Memphis. She liked likes the smell of cow manure and diesel fuel. I'm serious, but she likes nice things too. I mean, a pretty dress and a nice meal. Some women are like, well, you're not gonna catch me putting a worm on a hook. Well, a redneck girl doesn't mind that. Matter of fact, there was a redneck girl fishing one time and she kept catching all these fish. And some guy asked her, he goes, how come you're catching so many fish? She went, he goes, what? He goes, you gotta keep the worms warm.
Exhausted from our hunt for redneck girls, we had our final road meal for the Temples of Rock at Jim Neely's famous Interstate Barbecue.
We're here closing down our trip to Memphis and Nashville, the Tennessee trip, Sun Studios, and we've chosen the Interstate Barbecue, where the best pork house in Memphis. And inside, we've got all sorts of items here. You got your beef ribs, you got your pork ribs, your regular bologna, your beef bologna, Polish sausage, smoked sausage, rib tips, beef links, Texas footlong, all sorts of side stuff here, including the de rigueur sweetened iced tea. Sweet.
And that's a favorite around here.
Right now.
Look at that.
Here's the situation. All this stuff looks really good. This looks interesting. The barbecue spaghetti dinner. Interstate original, barbecue pork and a mixture of barbecue sauce, spices, spaghetti pasta with the slaw and bread that comes with everything else, all for $4.95. But what I'm gonna get is the sampler platter, also known as a trip to hog heaven. Pork ribs, beef ribs, links, brisket, pork shoulder, and the barbecue spaghetti with beans, slaw, and bread. So that's what I'm getting, and we'll see what that looks like in a minute. All right.
Oh, yeah. So why you had to move over here?
We had to move here because beef ribs, were for him. All right. We had to move here because the little table, this table, the normal size table, right, was impossible, right?
Yeah.
I hope we didn't make extra work here. I'm sorry.
No.
Okay. We'll just spread this stuff out here. Yeah, this is a side of spaghetti for you. It's your barbecue spaghetti.
That's all your stuff.
This is all mine, I know.
This is spaghetti, that's yours.
Oh, this is mine. Oh, this is my spaghetti.
Yeah, this is it.
That's the side,
that's the side.
Bigger.
Side. This is the...
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'll put it over there.
Got some Warner bread.
Oh, yeah. Look at this sucker over here. Right?
That sounds sweet, it sure tastes good.
Look at this. Unbelievable.
Let me see what you got there.
This is meat. I'm eating meat right here. This is meat. Mm. Oh, man. Oh, God. Mm. Sweet and tangy. Now, this is what we're
talking. What are some of the things you got on there?
Well, these are the beef ribs. These are your beef ribs. Oh, these are your pork ribs.
Yeah.
Okay. These are your beef ribs. This is the pulled pork, I believe. This is your sausage link smothered in barbecue sauce. This looks like beef brisket. Then we have potato salad, beans, coleslaw, and white bread. And here is the famous barbecue spaghetti.
Have you tasted it yet?
I'm going to taste it right now. First time ever anywhere. Yeah. A little bit like Chef Boyardee with hot sauce on it. Not thrilled about the spaghetti, but you know what? You got to try it.
But when are you ever going to have it?
When you ever have it again.
Another big eater there. Look at that sausage.
Yeah.
Okay, 10 minutes later.
Ta-da! We have the whole countdown clock on
now. Gone, gone, gone. So how would you rate it?
It's a once-in-a-lifetime meal. So you can afford to eat this twice. Outstanding. The best. The best barbecue we found in 5 days.
Do you have a rating system? Like, you know, Carlo's 1 star, 2 star.
This gets 3 red.
3 red. This gets the 3 redneck girl rating.
Okay. All right.
3 out of 3.
I can't believe we ate the whole thing.
Dear one, the world.
The experience of making the Temples of Rock was quite a memorable one. It wasn't easy, but in many ways it was a dream come true.
We're thankful to all those who supported us and helped along the way. It was living proof of the old adage, be careful of what you wish for, because you just might get it.
Is calling you.
That's all.